everyone. My name is Laura, and in today's lesson, I'll be discussing pleural effusion. By the end of this lecture, you should be able to confidently answer these questions. What are pleural effusions? How can we identify them? What are Light's criteria, and how do we use them? And what processes can cause pleural effusion? Here's an outline of what we'll discuss in this lecture. Let's address the first question in our objective. What are pleural effusions? To really understand what and where pleural effusions are, first we need to do a quick review of anatomy. The lungs and mediastinum are contained within the thoracic cavity, which is bordered on the outside by the rib cage. The rib cage and lungs are separated by a thin, continuous membrane called the pleura, which is divided conceptually into the visceral pleura, which lines the lungs, and the parietal pleura, which lines the rib cage. The area inside the visceral and parietal pleura is termed the pleural space. Really, this is a potential space, since it holds very small volumes of fluid, about 2 milliliters for lubrication at baseline, but has the capacity to hold much more. The fluid is constantly being turned over and is drained by local lymphatics. When fluid production increases, the lymphatic drainage system can get overwhelmed. The net increase in volume is called a pleural effusion. Our second question is, how do we identify an effusion? Effusions can be identified clinically with symptoms and signs or through imaging. We'll talk about clinical findings first. If effusions are small, they're typically asymptomatic. As they get larger, patients may begin to complain of dyspnea or shortness of breath. Dyspnea is the most common presentation of effusions and is the best indicator that an effusion needs intervention. Other symptoms may include orthopnea or shortness of breath with lying flat and paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea or waking up abruptly from sleep with cough and difficulty breathing. Depending on what's in the infusion, they can also be painful. On your physical exam, you might hear decreased breath sounds at the bases of the lungs. Depending on the cause of the effusion, the patient may have other fluid collections as well, such as in the lower extremities or the abdomen. If your history and physical exam suggests an effusion, imaging is the appropriate next step. A simple chest x-ray will help you answer questions like, is the effusion large or small? Unilateral or bilateral? Also, is the effusion loculated? Loculation, or encapsulation, is most common when the underlying effusion is due to hemothorax, pyothorax, pylothorax, or tuberculous pleuritis. The key findings to look for on an upright chest x-ray are blunted costophrenic angles, as shown by the arrow here. Since x-rays are only two-dimensional, consider multiple views, including lateral and decubitus angles, to get a better idea of the location and volume of the fluid. Other imaging modalities are more sensitive and can give you greater insight into the volume, identity, and potentially the source of the fluid. We've successfully proven that an effusion is present. There are two primary categories of physiologic processes that can cause effusions, transudative and exudative. The difference was originally defined in 1972 by Dr. Light and we still use his rules, or Light's criteria, in practice today. According to Light's criteria, if at least one of the following three criteria is present, the fluid is defined as an exudate. First, pleural fluid protein to serum ratio greater than 0.5, or 50%. 2. Pleural fluid lactate dehydrogenase, or LDH, to serum LDH ratio of greater than 0.6, or 60%. And 3. Pleural fluid LDH greater than 2/3 the upper limit of the laboratory's normal serum LDH. Requiring only one of the three has higher sensitivity but a lower specificity than each individual criterion. What processes can cause pleural effusion? The short answer is lots of them. So knowing whether an effusion is transudative with low protein and LDH or exudative with high protein and LDH will be critical to narrowing your differential diagnosis and finding out the source of the effusion. Actually sampling the fluid is necessary to run these tests. If a fluid is found to be transudative, you should consider abnormalities in three major organ systems: the heart, the kidneys, or the liver. With an exudative effusion, empyema, malignancy, hemothorax, or chylothorax should be considered. Other tests that can help you determine the source of the pleural effusion are listed here. Here are some pearls worth remembering. A low pH is either malignant or paraneumonic, more often than not. A glucose of less than 60 may be infectious or inflammatory. Fluid triglyceride levels should be checked if you suspect chylothorax. Consider a fluid amylase if you're concerned about pancreatitis or esophageal rupture. Let's apply what we know so far. A 45-year-old gentleman with no medical problems and a 20-pack-year history of smoking comes to your office complaining of fevers and cough. He's felt generally poor for the last week or so, but in the last 2 days, he developed trouble breathing, especially at night when he's trying to sleep, as well as fevers to 101 degrees Fahrenheit and a cough that is productive of greenish sputum. What should we do next? His physical exam shows a fever, tachycardia, and dullness at the left base. There's no other clinical evidence of total body volume overload. Here's his chest x-ray. Things we're worried about with unilateral effusions like this one include infectious or malignant causes. Hepatic hydrothorax is possible, but more commonly found on the right. DHF, renal failure, or liver failure would more likely be bilateral, and nothing in this patient's history suggests pancreatic disease or esophageal rupture. Putting his whole picture together, the fevers, cough, and unilateral fluid collection all suggest a paraneumonic effusion. What procedure might he need? What tests do we send to confirm our theory? You decide to send the fluid for LDH and protein, as well as pH, glucose, and amylase. Notice the fluid LDH and protein level. Using Light's criteria, is this fluid an exudate or a transudate? If you said exudate, you're correct. Since the fluid LDH is much higher than 60% of the serum LDH, and the fluid protein is greater than 50% of the serum protein. You also note that the fluid pH is 7.14. Normal fluid pH is 7.6. Transudates are usually 7.4 to 7.55. Most exudates are less than 7.3. Your next step would be to evacuate the rest of the fluid, culture it for infectious pathogens, and start antibiotics. Here's a summary of what we learned today. Pleural effusions are abnormal fluid collections in the pleural space between the visceral and parietal pleura in the thorax. Multiple imaging modalities can identify effusions. The appropriate first step is a chest X-ray. We use Light's criteria to identify effusions as transudative or exudative to help narrow the differential. Here are some great references for more reading. This concludes our lecture for today. Thank you for your attention.